Okay, welcome back, and we'll resume with the afternoon session.
Thanks. So yesterday, I hope I didn't overwhelm you too much with all those experimental facts and figures I showed you, but the idea was just to give you some perspective of what's out there and what are we actually trying to talk about, right? The second thing I hope you got from yesterday is that that now you understand what are the two defining properties of a superconductor, meaning zero resistivity and the Meissner effect, or this effect of flux expulsion out of the material, right? Okay, and I think I convinced you that it's not possible to understand these two things with this semi-classical picture of electrons flying around as a gas of charged particles, right? To get the zero resistivity, this guy suddenly stops seeing the lattice, imperfection, defects, and so on, all of a sudden. That's a bit weird, to take this tall, this scattering time to infinity, right? And also we saw that even assuming that, which is already weird, we would not be able to reproduce something like the Meissner effect just by taking the conductivity to be zero, by taking this scattering time tall to be infinity. So I hope you went out of the room a bit puzzled yesterday, right? And let's try to understand what kind of assumptions one needs to make, or what kind of modifications of what I showed you yesterday one needs to make to start understanding what's going on. So this London theory of equations is actually the first successful phenomenological theory that we found for superconductivity, and is the first thing I'm telling you about today. So you saw that the outline changed a little bit, and I hope to do this in the first half an hour or so. And then in the second part of this lecture to go to Ginzburg-Landau, mostly talking about this idea of microscopic quantum coherence, flux quantization, and how we actually recover London's equations from a completely different perspective without some assumptions we need to make here, what is nice. And then I left for tomorrow Josephson effect and its related applications. So I hope the time will, the timeline will be more or less like that. And sorry, before I start, there's a second remark. This is now online, the slides are online. I don't know if you got the chance to see it. And I add a small list of references that I might improve later today or even later this week. The first is really a very classical introductory text for superconductivity. The second one is one of Feynman lectures, actually the last one, what's really nice. And it really tells this story, most of the story I'm gonna tell you today in a nice way. So if you wanna go to that or have a reading reference, that's a good one. And then there are two solid state physics books, Kittel and Ashcroft and Merming. If you're not super familiar with things such as solid state in general, or this Drude theory for transport, you can read chapter one, for example, of Ashcroft and Merming. And they also have nice introductory chapters to superconductivity in each of them. And they also touch a little bit of BCS theory in a very qualitative manner. So it's probably interesting also to read, but that's something we're not gonna be talking about in the lectures. And as an extra, there are a couple of YouTube videos that I like very much. One is a colloquium, a series of colloquiums by Stephen Kivelstein on superconductivity, and also highlighting this aspect of microscopic coherence. And the second one is a series of lectures that Andy Millies gave in one of his Boulder summer schools. This is definitely a more advanced topic, because he essentially covers the microscopic theory of superconductivity and more advanced stuff. But the first minutes, he has really a nice discussion on what's the status of the theoretical understanding we have. So it also might be worth watching it. And I didn't know exactly how many minutes when I did that, because we didn't have internet here, but I will update. Okay, so that's how much I'm gonna use slides today. So let's go to the board now. So yesterday we saw, okay, there is no way to understand Meissner effect by taking Maxwell's equations and taking rho to be zero, right? So should we change Maxwell's equations? Does it sound like a good idea? Probably not, right? Superconductivity is a property of materials, so maybe it's something in the constitutive relations that is a bit different. So what London and London, there are two Londons, they did is essentially to actually counter this issue in a very smart way, which goes as follows. So they really start with this acceleration equation we wrote today, which is nothing but Newton's equation for a particle in a field. Right. So literally, I'm using this big chalk. Apparently, it's better for you to see in the back, but maybe my handwriting is not as beautiful. Let me know if it, you cannot understand what I'm writing. Okay. So we had that last yesterday, right? And then we got all these things that the velocity would increase at a rate determined by the charge, the mass, and the electric field applied, and that we could write the current, thank you, as the density of electrons, the charge, times the velocity, and we went from there. But what we did here, we integrated over time, remember? And then we said, oh, there is this tall, this characteristic scattering time. What London and London did, they said, let's not do that, because there is no such an idea of a resistivity anymore to start with. And that will become clear later, so let's not integrate. Let's use this as the fundamental equation. It's as if these electrons can be arbitrarily accelerated, what sounds unreasonable, but let's see what we get out of this. But if we want to keep this equation as something fundamental in some sense, the definition of current gets a bit iffy, so we can just write actually the time derivative of the current, not the current itself. So, fine. We get this. So this, one could say that it's the analogous of Ohm's law for a superconductor. And I really put quotes here because that's not something that we standardly say all the time. But it's really a relation between current and electric field, right? Before we had essentially that current is, yes, the conductivity or the other way around, yeah, times the electric field. This is just Ohm's law, right? But now the relation between current and field is fundamentally different, and we cannot really define something such as a conductivity or a resistivity just because the relation is different. So this looks a bit of a stretch, but let's see again what we get out of this. So let's use this again. Just let me write it down again for completeness. And let's do some manipulation and use some of the Maxwell equations. For example, we can start taking the curl. Uh, And let's say, let's use Faraday's equation to relate the electric field to the magnetic field, because we're interested in Meissner effect, so let's write things in terms of magnetic fields, right? So fine, we have the time derivative of the rotational of the current. It's minus n q square over m time derivative of the field. But we can also use another of Maxwell's equations to write actually the current in terms of magnetic field, right? Which one is that? Amperes, the last one, the current. So in absence of any time-dependent electric field, right? But here we have, sorry, let me be faithful to my notation. But here we have the rotational of the current, no problem, we can take the rotational of, we get the rotational of the field is equal to the 2 mu mu 0 rotation of the current. We know that the rotation of the field is minus the Laplacian of the field, right? So we have Laplacian of the time derivative. So the minus can go away with the minus on the other side. And there is a mu naught here. Well, I'm keeping a funny derivative. Let's use all partial derivatives, just because everything can have both spatial and and time derivatives. Just a second. Yeah. Where? Here? Oh, yes, in principle there is, I'm assuming there is not an externally applied time-dependent electric field, just a magnetic field. Not the point. Yeah, let's assume that there's just an electric field applied and I would expect a current to flow. In this case, it won't be a constant current, but it will be increased for something that is increasing with time. But the externally applied electric field is constant in time. That's why I'm dropping it in amperes as well. Okay, so all the steps I think sound reasonable with that assumption of some new Ohm's law. Yeah. So what I'll do here, I'll just integrate the time parts, and I can keep this as general as I want. So I have the field at some time minus the field at some initial time is equal to n square mu naught over m, again the field at some time minus the field at some initial time. And this you know how to solve. This is a simple differential equation It's just inhomogeneous, there's some constant terms there. Let's say there's some finite value for this magnetic field at zero time. But there are essentially two kinds of solutions. And what are they? And constant. Yeah, so essentially if we take, right, B to B equal, then trivially both sides are zero, nothing remarkable happens. Or we can take it to actually be something that still has some time dependence, which I don't know what it is, but has some exponentially decaying factor because of this. And then there will be a characteristic length scale that appears here. Which is called the London penetration depth. All right. Yes. Because everything is stemming from an externally applied electric field. So this definition, this redefinition of the current or of Ohm's law is independent if I have an external magnetic field or not. Right? It's just a constitutive relation that exists now once I apply a static electric field point. Yeah, that's the statement. Now, assuming that this is my new Ohm's law or my new constitutive relation, can I use what I know from electromagnetism and try to distill something about magnetic fields? Does that sound good? This is a solution. But how does that explain anything? So to actually see how this explains something, we actually need to officially solve this problem with some boundary conditions. For example, can you see this part? So let's assume we have actually a boundary between a normal metal and a superconductor. And we apply an external magnetic field now. The external magnetic field in the normal side of the material, or even vacuum, can be even vacuum on the left side, will be just whatever field I'm applying, essentially. But in the superconductor, it should follow this equation, meaning it will or be some constant, but the most interesting solution is actually this, in which it exponentially decays as soon as it gets in the superconductor. So if I would draw actually the behavior of the field with position, it would be a constant outside, but when it gets inside the superconductor, it decays exponentially fast with this characteristic scale of the London penetration depth. Meaning, if you go far enough inside the superconductor, you already don't see any magnetic field. No magnetic field should survive in there. All right? And that's the core of the Meissner effect. And for you to have an idea of how big this is, in typical conventional superconductors, this is about 50 to 500 nanometers. So if you have a sample you can hold in your hand, this length scale is something really, really small. So the bulk of the superconductor, meaning most of its volume, it really doesn't really have any field on it, any magnetic field on it. As they actually have observed in experiment 2 years before, So essentially these guys were looking for an explanation for that, and then 2 years later this comes up. So you see that this is rather phenomenological. There are some assumptions here which, if you take seriously, it just doesn't look very good. I'm saying things can accelerate arbitrarily as long as I keep an electric field. But if we overlook that and see the phenomenology we get, it's actually consistent with observation, right? Yes. Yes, good question. So if it was a normal material, in the sense that I have a non-zero resistivity, this would be the constitutive relation. And then, if you remember yesterday, the discussion towards the end, I showed you that there is no way that we can assume that the constitutive relation is this, taking rho to be zero afterwards. And it's not possible to find a path to explain the Meissner effect or the flux explosion. Now, if we assume a different relation, quote unquote, such that we cannot even define a resistivity or a conductivity, then we gain this effect. And that's what's different. So London actually noticed that there are two solutions, and he was not very happy. He said, okay, why? Oh, a question. See that I wouldn't say I was able to explain the resistivity, because to explain the resistivity I would need to take tall this scattering time to infinity, and that would happen all of a sudden, and we don't really have an explanation for that, right? So I wouldn't say I explained it. I would say we could understand as if things are not scattering anymore, but I didn't tell you how or why that was happening. So they kind of counter this. They don't go towards the path of defining a resistivity, but it's not completely orthogonal, because this is still one step. It's related to this previous step, right? This is still holds if I go to Ohm's law or if I go to this new constitutive relation. So they said, okay, let's. This is scattering time to define something like a resistivity or a conductivity. Let's just keep it as it is and use this as something fundamental. Meaning, let's not assume we can even define this to take this to zero afterwards. So, I don't know if I'm answering your question, but if I didn't answer yet, just ask me again or ask me later. Okay? Does it? Makes sense. Okay. Okay, so I was saying that there are these two kinds of solutions, and Lono was a bit upset because he saw this other solution and said, okay, why one, not the other? What can we do to avoid this solution? Where? Yes. Yes, actually, that's right. So essentially, we need to get rid of this constant of integration, meaning, or even better, get rid of the time integral at all. So what they did is to assume actually that the fundamental equation was this, but without the time derivatives. And you can postulate that and say that's the equation, right? So then there are the two London equations. Then we can write, which is essentially this one, and we can already write in terms of this London penetration depth. And a second one is actually related to this. And then we just get rid of the rotation on this section. Which is actually related to the very first assumption we started with. So they assume these two equations to be phenomenologically the two fundamental equations that describe superconductors with scale which depends on the charge density in the superconductor and the charge and the masses of this electronic gas still in this perspective. So fine, in principle, we have some taste of understanding something like the Meissner effect without going too far from basic electromagnetism, what's nice. but still, it doesn't answer perhaps the more fundamental question that was asked in the back, you know, but why would we start with that equation as something fundamental? How is that electrons don't see defects or the lattice or some dislocations? They don't bump into anything anymore, right? And that happens rather suddenly, right? If you remember from these two plots I showed you yesterday, the resistivity with respect to time, the resistivity was going down rather sharply. So this looks like something of the flavor of a phase transition, but resistivity is not a thermodynamic quantity, so we would better look at something thermodynamic to really characterize phase transitions, and one can do that, for example, by looking at specific heat. And they measure that, and they see a curve that looks more like this. So, and this is TC. So at the critical temperature, on top of the resistivity changing, the susceptibility getting starting to get lower towards -1, they also see a discontinuity in the specific heat. So this reminds us of something like a second order phase transition for the ones that already heard about it. And to talk about phase transitions and in particular second order phase transitions, then it's useful to think in terms of what is known as Landau theory for phase transitions. How many of you So, to introduce this idea, I will do the following. So I'll start with a question. Give me examples of phase transitions. Melting ice, yes. Boiling water, something else. Magnetization, something becomes a ferromagnet at below some temperature, right? More. Bose-Einstein condensation, great, that is related to this, to superconductivity. Essentially, a condensate is a superfluid, and it's essentially a chargeless superconductor. And that's a good one. More. I think that's good enough. So, conductivity. Thank you. I almost forgot about that. Okay. So now we can make a table, just to talk about phase transitions in general. And I might need more space. Oh, I can use that. So. So let's use the first example was the liquid-solid transition, right? So we have a disordered state at higher temperatures, which is the liquid, let's say. And then below some temperature, it becomes ordered by becoming a solid. then how can we characterize or quantify that you passed from one phase to another? Temperature, but what's in the material itself changes if you go below the transition temperature? Density, yeah. Cool. So we can associate this change in density as a qualitative, a quantitative measure of the transition. So to say, okay, am I here or am I here? So that introduces the idea of an order parameter. Which here could be, for example, the change in density from the liquid to the solid. Or I'm looking for something more specific. What property of changes when you go from a liquid to a solid? I just could not hear. That's something that will come next, in the next row of, I'm sorry. Let's say if I push a, let's say I push a bunch of water, and I push a cube of ice, different things happen, no? Simpler. Something, yeah, that's the nature of things I wanted to hear. So the fluid is kind of viscous, right? You can, there is this idea of flows, there's some viscosity, but the solid does not. If you poke it here, it will just jump it, right? There is no fluidity. So there is this idea of, I'll call here K, but it's, what I mean is some kind of rigidity or some shear modulus or something of this nature, right? That is there in the solid, but it's zero when you're in the liquid. So let me just write something here before we finish the table. So order parameter is really a quantifier of how order state, how if you are in the ordered state or not, or how much order you have in the ordered state. So it's usually some magnitude of some quantity, can be a number, a vector in different dimensions. but it's zero, let's say, in the disordered phase at higher temperatures, and it's something finite below it. Simple as that. Okay, but then there was an interesting comment here. There's something about what did you say before? Something about geometry, right? So you form a solid, you have a lattice, and that lattice has some very well defined symmetries. You can just rotate it in very specific ways so that it falls in itself. It's not like empty space. So then what you have here, it's another concept that is also related, which is symmetry breaking. And I already gave the answer, right? What's the symmetry that is broken once you go from a liquid that looks something more isotropic to a solid, which is something that just very specific transformations take it to itself. We break translation symmetry. Good. So then we can go to the other example. Somebody said the magnet. True. But in the sense, yeah, I can add that. Fine. That sounds meaningful, right? Another example was a ferromagnet. Which has as a disordered state some kind of paramagnet. You have just some spins that are floating around, but they're not ordered. But below some temperature, they all align in the same direction. And there are different flavors of ferromagnetism. Essentially, how constrained is this spin to start with? Is it a SU2 spin? Can it point in any direction? Or is it just locked to the XY plane because the crystal in which this spin is embedded energetically favors the spin just to point in one plane? So then it's what we call the XY magnets. And there is even a further version of this which is even more constrained, that you probably know about. How is it called? Ising, where the spin can just point essentially up and down, just in one direction. Right. So there is Ising, there is XY, and there is what's called the Heisenberg. And then the other parameter for all of them is the overall magnetization in some direction, but given the constraints you have here to start with, this order parameter will be just a number because it's just one direction, right? This one will be a vector in the plane because the spin is constrained to the plane, and this will be a three-dimensional vector, let's say, in the classical sense, or a spin with three different projected directions. So then it can be, let's say, the order parameter will be for the Ising, and let's say just in the z direction. Here you have a vector, but in two dimensions, and here also a vector, but let's say in a classical picture, right, in three dimensions. Now, what about the symmetries I'm breaking in each case? Is that too wide? Can flip up and down? So Z2 means I have a group of transformations that is just composed of the identity, or taking whatever I have to minus itself. So these are the only things I can do, essentially what characterizes this degree of freedom, right? And then once I select one specific direction, when I become order, meaning or up or down, not the direction, because the direction is the same, then I'm breaking the Z2 symmetry. Here, if I have something that can rotate in the plane, what would be the analog? U1. And for this Heisenberg guy, SU2 or O3, right? O3 if it's more of a classical object. Okay, and we almost forgot the most interesting one, which is a superconductor. And the disordered state, we usually say it's a normal metal. But what's the order parameter? The order parameter is some observable I can measure in the system. Yeah, but the resistivity is not something that I can couple to like the magnetization, right? I have this, I can go there and measure the magnetization, I can couple a magnetic field to the magnetization and access it, measure susceptibility and so on. And what for the superconductors? So see that susceptibility would not be the intrinsic observable of the constituent material, right? It's a property of the overall material. As if I could not say that susceptibility is the order parameter, for example, for the, I don't know where the question came from, sorry. Yeah, again, it's not thermodynamic quantity, it's a transport quantity. That's interesting, yeah. How can you quantify superfluidity? Yes, that's good. So it's something in that direction. So we need to quantify, essentially, how many of these electrons are not seeing the defects and everything, right? But it's something very subtle, and I won't fill in the blanks yet. But you see that it is something very non-intuitive. Okay, you have spins, you have magnetization, you can measure, you can couple to it in a very clear manner, you can measure specific heat susceptibility, you can characterize it, but for this thing, we don't even know what field would couple to this order parameter, whatever it is. Right? There's no magnetic field that couples to the superconducting order parameter. In the same way, there is a magnetic field that couples to the magnetization. That's why this is this was not understood for such a long time, because it's not very non-intuitive. Okay, so I'll not answer this question yet. I will discuss Landau theory, thinking about magnets, because this thing we understand better, right? So let's just construct the framework thinking about magnets. So what Landau theory is about, it's a theory to describe phase transitions. So at the phase transition, we expect that the order parameter will go, specifically second order phase transitions, when the order parameter comes out of zero in a continuous way. Meaning above TC, it's zero, but below TC, it starts to be zero, and then as I lower the temperature, it gets higher, higher and higher. So he thought, okay, I want to describe this, so let's write a free energy. And let's write a free energy as an expansion in powers of this order parameter. Because I know that the free energy for the other ordered state will be essentially a small modification to the free energy of the disordered state, and then I can just assume that there is an expansion and see what I get. So from that we can write a free energy as a function of the order parameter. In principle, this is a functional because this order parameter itself can depend in time and space. Okay. And he simply said bluntly that there is such an expansion. And let's start thinking about the Eisen case because it's simpler. Because the order parameter is just a number. So this psi is an order parameter. And keep in mind for now that it's just mz, but could be other things. And you just say there is some constant a, some constant b, and some expansion of this form. Yes? That was my next question. Thank you. Why are there just even powers? Because of symmetry. Because I want that my free energy or my energy to be invariant if I choose the states, the final states should be up or down in principle. There is nothing in the world that tells me that one is better than the other unless I apply an external field and explicitly give you the direction. So far, yes. If it was some other models, these things would be vectors, but still it would be squared because it eliminates the direction. For example, for the Heisenberg of the X or the XY, the symmetry is the rotational symmetry. So instead of just a square, I'll take the scalar product, which is invariant under rotations. So then my free energy would be written in terms of powers of the scalar product. Right? Cool. And just to write here, these parameters are we don't know what they are. So that's a free energy. So if I want to describe my system, usually physics, in physics we like to think about minimization principles, right? So whatever value this quantity will acquire will be probably the value that minimizes this free energy. So then we can take the derivative. And then if A and B are larger than zero, what's the value of psi that minimizes the energy? Zero, right? So we'll call this value that minimizes the energy zero, psi naught. And then Landau noticed, if I want to get something non-zero there, I'd better make A negative at the transition. So he bluntly assumed that actually A is A naught times T minus TC, such that this is larger than zero if T is larger than TC, and smaller than zero if T is smaller than TC. It's the simplest thing I can do to capture a change from an order parameter that's zero to something finite, right? Yeah, I'm being this is integral of free energy density, where I'm there. But I'm skipping that just for the sake of speed. But we'll go back to that when we talk about the Ginzburg one. Good. So what's the value which minimizes now the energy if we have this form of A0, right? So now if T is smaller than TC, there is another solution here. And pictorially, we can see it like this. So this is essentially the energy. Now just bound is just a number, right? So it looks like this. If T is larger than TC, meaning the minimum is at zero, the order parameter value is zero, but if we are below TC and the quadratic term becomes negative, it will look like this, right? Now the minima of this function are not at zero. Some value psi naught minus psi naught, which we can find from this equation. So it's zero if T is larger than TC, or is equal to plus or minus the square root of E over A. Yes, if T is smaller than to C, or I can write like this. Okay, so if I assume this construction below to C, there are two different values. The order parameter which minimizes my energy. And if I go to the laboratory and I take a piece of iron and I lower its temperature, I see that it becomes ferromagnet, but it has a very specific direction. Right? In some sense, physically we're choosing or this minimum or this minimum. So then here we have this idea of spontaneous symmetry breaking, that actually physically you end up in one place or another. Completeness, right? How the evolution of the order parameter itself with temperature goes. It's something like this. So it's zero above TC and goes to this A0 TC over the value at zero temperature. So okay, this looks all good. And since we have a free energy now, we can actually substitute this value that minimizes it. So now we have essentially a free energy in terms of temperature and external field. Also add, for example, explicitly the magnetic field. And then we can get the thermodynamics out of it. We can get entropy, specific heat, just by taking the derivative with respect to temperature. And that I'm sure you're familiar with. So then, for example, entropy will be zero, or the minus A0 square T minus TC over 2B, and then specific heat. Nothing but the second derivative with respect to temperature. And these two values refer to T larger than TC or T smaller than TC. Okay. And here you can see that the change of the order parameter is continuous out of TC. It comes out of zero. The change in entropy is also continuous because at TC this is zero and then it starts to flow down. But the change in specific heat is not, because at TC it goes from zero to something finite. So this really is the essence of a second order phase transition. The second derivative is not continuous, and it really captures the magnitude of this jump here. So this is actually the change from the normal state to the superconducting state, because I'm not saying anything about the normal state. I'm assuming it's all in the background. Fine, so an extra remark about this is that note that we start with this A and B rather phenomenologically, but once you can measure what's the critical temperature, what's the magnitude of this jump in the specific heat, and how fast this order parameter grows out of zero, then you can actually know what these numbers are, even if you don't know exactly from the microscopics where they're coming from. You can in principle reconstruct these numbers from experimental data. Yeah. Sorry. Okay. Psi is in principle any order parameter, which could be a number like a changing density or the projection of spin in the z direction if I'm talking about isospins. And for that discussion was constructed assuming it's a number, right? But it could also be a vector or something else. Would be mz, for example. Alright? Yeah, it would be minus a value or plus a value for the whole volume of the sample. Yes, it's just this general minimization principle that we found. Okay. There is a lot one can say about this construction, but I want to talk about the XY case. And then we move to the Ginzburg-Landau and superconductivity, because there is a motivation from there that I want to point out. So, again, thank you for the question. What's psi? Psi is a generic order parameter. Here is just a number for the Eisen case. But let's say I have the xy spin. Now the other parameter is a vector, and have an mx and an my component. So if I would draw the free energy, let's really write mx and my now. I actually need a three-dimensional plot, and we need a bit of imagination here. So in terms of magnitudes, we would find really the same thing. What we would do for the xy case, instead of psi square in the free energy, we write psi dot psi, psi dot psi, which is essentially the modulus of psi. So in a given direction, we would find the same picture, but it doesn't depend on the direction I'm pointing to. The free energy would be the same, right? So then we have this picture of this Mexican hat. This is the back, this is the front, this is the back, and this is the front. Now instead of just two points, which minimize my energy, I have a whole set of points along this along the bottom of this Mexican hat, that all of them do as well energetically speaking as the others. But again, we run into the problem. Going to the laboratory, we lower the temperature, we see that the ferromagnet is pointing in a very specific direction. So, and on top of that, if you think locally, it's almost as if the magnetization could be in any direction in different points of space. What doesn't look very good, because you know that the ferromagnets, all of them are pointing in the same direction. So there should be an associated energy cost to allow for this changing direction of the order parameter. Because I want them to be all in the same direction. That's what we observe, right? And that relates more or less to some idea of rigidity, some idea of energy cost towards the formation, but now of the order parameter, not of the solids. So with that in mind, Ginzburg and Landau developed their theory, actually motivated by superconductivity. And then it really became clear how this term associated with rigidity of the order parameter is actually key to understand superfluid flow and other things such as the Meissner effect. So I'll now jump to Ginzburg-Landau theory. But then, if I want to talk about superconductivity, we run into this problem, right? What's the order parameter? Okay, I can construct some free energy, which is an expansion of the order parameter, but we don't know what it is. And they also didn't know what it is and what it was. So essentially, they assumed that it's a complex number. And then you can crank things down and see what you get. And actually, turns out that you can get quite interesting things if you assume it's a complex number. So, now what, when I say a complex number, perhaps quantum mechanics, does it remind you of anything? It's a psi, yeah, it's suggestive. I did that on purpose to some extent. A field, a wave function, right? A complex order, a complex number. Now, how can a wave function be a order parameter? So I think the beauty of superconductivity is actually it's not a one particle phenomenon. So we're usually thinking about quantum mechanics, problems in quantum mechanics. You have one particle in a box. You have the hydrogen atom, which is a true particle problem. And then you solve them, and then you get the wave function. There are some approximations you do, and so on. But it's essentially a single particle problem. Right? Here, actually, you have a bunch of electrons. You have 10 to the 23 electrons inside the material. And you want to solve the entire problem and see how these guys behave all together. So the idea of a wave function really here gets some classical reality in a very interesting way. Because we are used from our training in next to think about the wave function in terms of a probability, right? The amplitude, the mod square of psi gives you the probability of finding a given point in space. So if I would draw some generic wave function mod square, So if I am here, I have a higher probability to find a particle than if I'm here, right? So we all know that. But now imagine that I put a lot of particles in a ground state which has this wave function. So I will naively fill in here with particles. I see some very uncomfortable people, but I want to stick to the idea. let's assume I can put a bunch of particles in a given quantum state. Why not? So then if I go there to the laboratory and measure actually the density distribution of a lot of these guys, I actually get mod squared of psi. Isn't that cool? So in this sense, we have some macroscopic quantum phenomena, or something that acquires some so-called classical reality, but not in the sense of the standard correspondence theory when you really go to large quantum numbers or large energies, but really because you have many particles in the same state. Right? You probably, maybe some of you heard about Bose condensates, and they can actually, so they put all these atoms in a trap, and then they cool them really cold, and they all go to their bosons, they all go to the same state at very low temperature, and they can measure the density profile by some optical approach. So they're essentially measuring this, so this is real. But it really is not intuitive, right? But there is a small problem here, right? What kind of particles are we talking about? Can we put a bunch of electrons in the same state? Okay, some of you I'm sure know the answer already, right? So the problem of doing this with electrons is just not possible, you know? But if these are bosons, then we can do it. How can we get bosons out of fermions? We can pair two fermions, you simply get a boson. If you form a bound state of two electrons, you can treat this effectively as a boson. And then we can do that. And I'm not telling you anything about the BCS theory, Cooper pairing, and so on. In some of these references I mentioned in the beginning, you can get a flavor of that. But that's essentially also another key ingredient, which came actually much later, essentially five to seven years after this, which was developed in 1950, and this BCS theory came out around 57. So they did all this without really being very aware of this idea of Cooper pairing. It was really a blunt assumption. So now let's write the free energy in the same spirit as we were doing before, but now including this extra cost to... Oh, actually I should have finished the table, sorry. So, well, I just told you this is a complex number. And then what's the symmetry? So it's U1 again. So then you complete the table. Okay, so now we have the analog Ginzburg-Landau functional of the order parameter. And here I will go to the spatial dependence as an integral of a functional density, which could be in any dimensions you want. Which now is a function of the order parameter itself and its gradient. So it's a function of its gradient because I'm explicitly introducing an energy cost associated with having changes of the order parameter in this manifold that minimizes the energy, because I want it in principle is the analog of having all the spins in the ferromagnet pointing in the same direction. So how to enforce that is by a term that looks like a kinetic term. And I could have put any here. I just put 8^2m because it resembles a kinetic term. But in the same way I was using A and B there, I could have put a C here and kept going. Right. And now to have the terms invariant with respect to this U1, how should I write the terms, the quadratic and the fourth term? Psi square is enough. Modulus of psi. So from this form, it's interesting to see already that we have a new length scale appearing. So from Landau's theory, we saw there was this London penetration depth, right? How far in the superconductor the magnetic field would penetrate. But here, because all these terms should be dimensionally equivalent, or it's an energy density, right? This A, B, and this factor should have the correct dimensions. So it doesn't matter what the dimension of psi is, because these two guys, the psi comes in squared, whatever comes in with it should have the same units, right? So essentially the units of h^2m nabla should be the same units as A. So everything is dimensionally consistent. And nabla squared. And nabla square essentially is 1/length square. So we can now define this second length scale. Which is called the coherence length. Which really characterizes how fast the order parameter itself changes when you get close, for example, to a normal superconducting edge. As before, we had the magnetic field, but now we have, let's say, normal metal superconductor. Deep inside the superconductor, there is a constant value that we find, as we found there, but as you come closer to the border, the gradient terms start to be important, and then you get something like this. And this scale is characterized by this coherence line. And that I'll leave you as an exercise for you to see actually I will spell that out a bit more and put it online. You can actually so minimize this energy to find what's actually the functional form of this curve and how this quantity appears there very explicitly. Okay? An interesting point that we get out of this construction is about the characteristic velocity of this fluid and how is it possible that these electrons are flowing around without bumping into anything or each other. And one can do that really thinking about currents that you get out of the quantum mechanical current you know of. If you treat psi as a probability density, you have a continuity equation, right? And then you have the associated current coming out of gradients of the wave function itself. So you are familiar with this. Where psi is your wave function, right? But if we raise this object from a wave function to an order parameter, as I argued to you a few minutes ago, is a complex number which has a magnitude and a phase. So we can write explicitly them separately. And let's assume that deep inside of the superconductor, the magnitude of the order parameter, which is actually this, it's really flat, it doesn't really oscillate or do weird things. So if anything is doing something weird, it would be the phase. So we assume that there is no gradients for psi. And then if we plug this in, the current, and take the derivatives just with respect of the phase factor, what we find essentially is this. And that's a simple exercise. And then we can write perhaps in a more suggestive way. Well, we can already get this. This already looks like something we had from the beginning. So we can associate this mod squared with the density, as someone mentioned earlier. So we call this the superfluid density. So how many of these electrons are actually superconducting-like or forming Cooper pairs so they can go to this state and be their own in the same state with the same velocity. So gradient of theta. So the bottom line here is this gradient of theta. So essentially we have some factor here that we had before for the current, density times charge over mass, right? So if we overlook that because we are coming from the mechanical simple formula for the current and assume that this density is already carrying the charge associated with it and so on and so forth. But the important aspect here is that this quantity is essentially giving you the velocity. The fact that you have a non-zero gradient of the phase is giving you a finite velocity. And since these guys are all in the same phase, in the same state, meaning with the same wave function, they will all flow with the same velocity. So So have now all these guys flowing coherently, not bumping into each other or into anything. So this is one way to understand how that's possible to flow without any kind of scattering. It's just because this, all these guys are exactly in the same state. So you cannot just jump from one state to another if they're all in the same state. So this introduces this idea of super fluid velocity and also coherence transport. So we have very few minutes left. I would like to talk about what happens when you add magnetic field to this picture, how you implement magnetic field here now, because the other parameter is not a magnetization, right? I cannot just couple with the term there minus m dot b or minus psi times b, because the field won't couple to the order parameter. It's not a magnetic moment or a spin or anything like that. So it's a bit subtle and interesting how it is, how it comes in. And out of that, we can see something really nice, which is flux quantization. And we can actually also show that we are able to recover London's equations, the equations we got in the first half of the lecture, without the time derivative. So all that assumption that London did, which was rather semi-classical and a bit problematic, we can actually now understand how consistent and beautiful it is in this quantum mechanical context. So that assumption of blending, dropping the time derivatives of those equations is actually associated with all this construction of Ginzburg and Landau very naturally. So that's something I'll leave for Friday with more time. Okay. And then I'll stop here and see if I have further questions.
Can we find a relation between different phase transitions with the same broken group? For example, paramagnet, ferromagnet in the XY model and superconductivity have the same group. Can we find a relation between these transitions?
Yes. Yes. So all this construction, if you keep the psi's and you don't tell, if I don't tell you what the psi means, if I don't tell you if it's a or some XY system or something, let's say, let's stick to the XY and something that also has the same symmetry, such that the order parameters are written in the same way as psi, scalar product, psi, and expansion, and powers of that combination in the free energy. It really doesn't matter what it is. If I'm doing this phenomenological approach, I have A, B, and the other terms. So all the thermodynamics you would get and the critical exponents, we say how this, for example, the susceptibility diverges at the critical point when you go to the critical temperature, all these things are rather universal if you have the same underlying properties in terms of symmetries.
Anyone else? Let's thank her again. And we have coffee upstairs, and then we come back for the discussion session in half an hour.
So during coffee, so the discussion session doesn't have to be questions directly related to the lectures. Okay, so the lecturers will be here, but you can think of questions you want to ask maybe later.